It's a great pleasure to be here tonight to talk about not only the Shinnecock Bay hope spot, but hope spots in general, and why we should have hope, why I have hope, why we all need to have hope. So the Shinnecock Bay hope spot, oh good. Almost exactly 1 year ago today in this very room, the Shinnecock Bay Hope Spot was launched, officially announced. And this Hope Spot was co-nominated by my institute, the Institute for Ocean Conservation Science, and very importantly, the Explorers Club. So we are co-champions of the Shinnecock Bay Hope Spot. And so this is just showing what happened a year ago. And what I want to do tonight is bring you up to date. I'll tell you a little bit about the origin story, just so that everyone is on the same page, and really bring you up to date on what we're doing now and what we hope to do. So hope spots can be hope spots for many, many different reasons. And the Shinnecock Bay hope spot really does have many dimensions that give us hope. It's full of biodiversity. It's full of biodiversity and human cultures, a rich tradition of people, and so many things. But I think the thing that really stands out for this hope spot, especially compared with many of the other hope spots, is that the hope comes from the fact that it demonstrated that we can change, we can turn things around, we can undo the harm that we've done to ecosystems. So when I first got to Shinnecock Bay, the water looked like this. It was brown, and it had been that way since 1985. Every year, there was a brown tide, and it covered a huge portion of the bay. And that brown tide led to a death spiral. It cut the water, prevented sunlight from cutting through to the water, and the seagrasses died. When the seagrasses died, there was no habitat for the fish. And the clam populations collapsed. It really was in terrible, terrible shape. And about a decade ago, I and my colleagues at Stony Brook University decided, you know what, it's time to stop just documenting the problems. Let's try to fix this place. And so we did try to fix the place. And the heart of our solution is what we call hard clam sanctuaries. These are no-take areas that have been planted with large adult clams. And these clams are ready to filter the water, restore the natural filtration capacity of the bay. And our theory was, if we could clean up the water, the rest of the ecosystem would begin to respond. The seagrasses could come back. The harmful algal blooms would stop. That's what we hoped. And this shows the main locations for those hard clam sanctuaries, no-take zones. So I'm cutting right to the bottom line here, what happened. After 10 years, so when we started, you know, people would say, Ellen, when do you think we're going to start to see a difference? And I would say, well, you know, I'm not really clear on when that might be. Maybe, you know, I hope that within 5 years or so, we might start to make a dent in the problem. But actually, by 10 years, it was clear that not only have we made a dent in the problem, but we had really turned the problem around. We had successfully restored Shinnecock Bay. The brown tides, that brown water, those were eliminated, those harmful algal blooms. We have not seen a brown tide in Shinnecock Bay in 5 years. The first time it happened, we thought, wow, are we just lucky this year? But the fact that this has continued 5 years in a row really makes us think that we have actually eradicated the main cause of the degradation of the rest of the system. The clam population has flourished by 2,000-fold. It's just incredible. The clams that we planted, they reproduced, they produced more clams, and those clams produced more clams, and so on and so forth. And now there are clams in many parts of the bay, not just the parts that we planted. The seagrasses have made a major comeback. We have about four times the area of seagrass now in Shinnecock Bay than when we started. And fish and other wildlife are thriving. The forage fish, the small fish that everything else depends upon, all the bigger fish depend upon, and the seabirds and the mammals, they have increased fourfold in abundance over this 10-year period. And people can now enjoy a healthy and safe environment. And this was the inspiration, really, for saying, you know, this story can give people, it gives me, a lot of hope that with science, guided by science, with persistence, with hard work, we can turn things around. And in fact, in this case, we did. We turned brown tide blue. This is what Shinnecock Bay looks like on most days today. Wow. So I continue to be inspired by Shinnecock Bay every day when I'm there and on the water and seeing the wildlife and seeing more wildlife and more good things happening. It really makes me happy. So this idea of hope not only resonated with us, but the media seemed to like the idea and amplified it. This is the local paper where Shinnecock Bay is located in the town of Southampton. And we got the front page above the fold. After years of decay, a ray of hope. NBC News covered the Shinnecock Bay Global Hope Spot and talked about how this was an example that could be followed globally. That, again, we can turn things around. It's not all doom and gloom. We can make a change. And then last fall, our team published a paper in Frontiers of Marine Science, which documents, and again, this is for the scientifically minded of you, if you really want to know all the details, they're in here, exactly what was done and how and what the result was. That's the beginning of our what we hope will be a toolkit, as we heard about during Coral Hour. Okay, so one of the things we did last year, we want to do more to engage the community. We took a field trip to Shinnecock Bay. A lot of the people on this trip are in this room. We're members of the Explorers Club. And I want to point out this person right here. This is Judith Weiss. Judith Weiss is a professor emerita from Rutgers University. And she was so inspired by the Shinnecock Bay Hope Spot that she decided, you know, I think I'll nominate the place I've been working to be a hope spot. And later on that summer, she happened to have spent some time with Sylvia Earle, and she talked with Sylvia and said, do you think this is a crazy idea? Or do you think it could work? And hopefully I'm not giving away too much of the next story, but in fact, she and others did nominate the New York-New Jersey Harbor to be a hope spot, and that just happened this year. So I love the Hope Spot program, and I think we have a lot of proof now that not only is there a lot of hope to be found out there, but that hope begets hope. Hope begets action. So I'm going to skip through this and just say, because in the interest of time, we have a lot of work ahead of us. We're not done. There are always new threats, and the threats that we have are always increasing. And we need to make sure that we can secure the future of Shinnecock Bay. We've also taken some new directions. We look at Shinnecock Bay as a test bed for innovative new science. And that's because of the wealth of data, the amazing database that we've collected over the years, more than a decade of really intense science. And we can use this to provide proof of concept for new technologies and then hope that they can go out and start exploring the oceans more broadly. Enhanced engagement with stakeholders, particularly the Shinnecock Indian Nation, they're now partnering with us, and to continue to spread the word locally and globally. In the near term, we are making headway in our plans to try to have an expedition that we call the All Shinnecock Expedition in 2024. It's going to be all Shinnecock because it's going to include the wild diversity of species. As I said, we have a partnership now with the Shinnecock Indian Nation, so we will be able to have, you know, complete partnership in every phase of the work. We will share knowledge, we'll share science, we'll work in each other's waters, we'll work together. And we're employing these new and emerging technologies in Shinnecock Bay and using eDNA, in situ sensors, and USVs. So really, that's what I have to say. That we are having another field trip and day of activities at Shinnecock Bay this week on Friday. The boat trips, unfortunately, sold out right away. We're really fortunate that Sylvia Earle will be with us and the Mission Blue team the whole day. And there are still tickets available for the 4 p.m. event. So if you haven't decided what you want to do on Friday, maybe come out and be inspired by Shinnecock Bay. And thank you. So I'd like to ask Christina Janulis to come up, and she's going to talk to us about Blue Gen.
Hello. Thank you, Ellen, for that. That's an amazing summary of all the work you've been doing. I can't believe you fit it into that short of a presentation. It's been years in the making. Hi, I'm Christina. And just in that theme of hope and sharing ideas and making change, we wanted to take a second to acknowledge the Blue Generation program we've been running. It's the second year now. So it's basically early career emerging explorers and ocean professionals and leaders who we bring to the club during World Oceans Week. And we put them in a program that's very peer-to-peer learning focused and interactive. So we kicked it off yesterday with Francois Ballet from the UN, who asked the very simple question of who governs the oceans, which he tried to squeeze into 3 hours, which was also impossible. And then today we heard from Schmidt Marine Technology Partners, and we heard from coral gardeners about coral restoration. We also had those, I believe Richard Garrett mentioned it, but the like leading edge technologies we have showcased downstairs, just to plug that one more time. I just wanted to say that if you're around tonight, if you're sticking around for the week, the Blue Generation participants, there's about 35 of them. They're kind of 20s-ish range, and they're wearing blue lanyards. So I know they would love to engage with you all and hear about what you're doing and just, yeah, talk about what they're excited about. So just to let you know that they're around and they're excited. And, yeah, that's pretty much all I have to say. And I want to invite Shannon Rake, who is the Hope Spot Program Manager for Mission Blue, and I'm sure she'll have something awesome for you. So.
All right, thank you, Christina. All justice for the vertically challenged. We're super thrilled to be here this week. Thank you so much to the Explorers Club for hosting an amazing week of programming and events. Huge thank yous are in order for Ted Janulis, Oceans Week Founding Chair and Explorers Club President Emeritus, Julie and Alex Wallace, Club Fellows, Oceans Week Co-Chairs, and Richard Garriott, who you heard from earlier, Explorers Club President, as well as the entire Explorers Club team, who I have been working fervently behind the scenes on tonight, and they've been working so hard on all the week's events, so thank you to all of you as well. I wanted to take also a moment to thank Rolex for their incredible work, their support for World Oceans Week at the Explorers Club, and also their support for conservation projects and NGOs, including Mission Blue. Rolex is doing incredible work with their Perpetual Planet Initiative, which you saw a quick video of earlier, and their support to Mission Blue is invaluable, and we're truly grateful, so thank you for that. So I'm going to give you a little bit of a background about how Mission Blue started. As some of you may know, Mission Blue was founded by Dr. Sylvia Earle. Sylvia is a National Geographic Explorer at Large, aquanaut, author, lecturer, all-around amazing human being, and certainly one of my favorite marine creatures. I'm telling you, she's not all human. So Sylvia gave a TED Talk in 2009, and her TED wish was to create a global network of marine protected areas large enough to save and restore the blue heart of the planet. She won the TED Prize and shortly after founded Mission Blue. So in 2010, Mission Blue was off and running, designating hope spots. It was mostly at high-level congresses and conferences, the impacts, the IUCNs, the UN Ocean conferences, really areas being identified at very high level through high-level scientists around the globe. And then the Mission Blue film came out, and people got to know more about Mission Blue, and people started reaching out, and they were saying, hey, we need your help. Can you help us? You know, we're doing all this great work, but our elected officials aren't listening. We have this amazing community behind this great work, but we need your help. Is there anything you can do to help? So in 2016, we opened up nominations to the public, and we were overwhelmed with the global desire to have help, and we have been happy to expand Hope Spots over the years. And today, even though earlier it was 140, that film is a little bit old, we actually have officially 154 Hope Spots globally as of today. So we are continuing on, and there's so many amazing speakers that we've heard from today, so many partners of Mission Blues here, and for everybody joining on the live stream at home, wherever you are, you can make a difference. As Sylvia says, one person can't do everything, but everyone can do something. And I think hopefully you're going to get some an infusion of hope tonight from some of our amazing champions talking about their work that they're doing in Hope Spots, and maybe how you can be engaged or you can be inspired to do something in your neck of the woods. So I am going to jump into presentations so you can learn more from our amazing Hope Spot champions. I'm excited to announce our first presenter. As Ellen mentioned, Judith, who is a co-champion for the New York-New Jersey Harbor Estuary, she's actually at Capitol Hill Oceans Week, so she couldn't be here tonight. But amazingly enough, we have Robert Pirani, champion for the New York-New Jersey Harbor Estuary Hope Spot. Robert is the program director for the New York-New Jersey Harbor and Estuary Program at the Hudson River Foundation. HEP is a collaboration of government, scientists, and civic sector that helps protect, restore, and provide access to the Hudson River Estuary. It is one of 28 programs around the country authorized under the Clean Water Act. Prior to joining the foundation in 2014, Mr. Pirani was Vice President for Energy and Environment at Regional Plan Association and Executive Director at the Governor's Island Alliance. Mr. Pirani has received awards from the Environmental Advocates of New York, National Trust for Historic Preservation, and the New York Harbor School Foundation. Please welcome Robert.
Well, thank you, Shannon, for that introduction. And it's such an honor to be here and to be here with Sylvia Earle, one of the great heroes of oceanography and marine conservation, and the rest of you here, and all the fantastic work that you do. I am going to talk very quickly, being here in New York and being a New Yorker, give you a quick tour of the Harbor Estuary and what it is. And I'm sure it's going to be maybe for the New Yorkers among us the least exotic place you're going to hear about tonight, but hopefully it's going to be an inspiration for you all to discover nature right here on the shores of Manhattan and the rest of New York and New Jersey. Let me launch right in. So you are here at the Explorers Club, right in the heart of a 16,000 square mile watershed that drains the Hudson, the Raritan, the Passaic, the Hackensack, and other rivers down towards the ocean. And, you know, like other estuaries around the world, that tidal flow, in our case, it's every day 60 billion gallons of water passing through the Sandy Hook Narrows, and about 80 billion gallons coming out, you know, that drives just the incredible rich and productive ecosystem here in the estuary. You know, again, something that happens on tidal estuaries all around the planet. But for us, what's really striking, of course, is that it's New York, right? It's 14 million people that live right there with that incredible ecosystem. It's the largest public space in the nation's biggest city, and we'd like to say the best city. But, and I'm sure you'll all agree. And for us, it's just that incredible juxtaposition between nature and people, and nature with people, that makes this estuary so important and why we're so grateful to be designated as a hope spot. The reason that I think Judith, Dr. Weiss, and unfortunately she couldn't be here today, but the reason she wanted to tell the story to the world about our work here is really the success we've had thanks to the Clean Water Act and billions of dollars of investment at the federal, state, from the ratepayers to improve water quality. Over the last generation, we've seen an ecosystem that had hypoxia happening routinely to a place where it's very unusual. That benefits of water quality and again, the hard work of as the Harbor and Estuary Program and the Hudson River Foundation, we work in collaboration with a number of agency and civic and scientific partners. So I'm here, and if Judith was here too, she would tell you it's not us that are doing this work, it's all of us together. And the Harbor Estuary really serves as that convening, that collaboration, to try to get people on the same page in terms of goals for restoration and water quality and public access. But through that work of all those partners, it's been a success. And the result is that the life here in the estuary is both coming back and is much more appreciated by the people who live here, because the waterways are so much more accessible. Whether it's glass eels, which David's going to come up in a minute and tell you where this eel came from in the Sargasso Sea. I understand that's going to be the big reveal tonight. Is he's got pictures of eels spawning. Sorry. I thought that was in the program. But from glass eels to our local resident oysters. This one was named Big by the marine biologists in the River Project and Hudson River Park. To the incredible flourishing of forage fish like menhaden and herring, and of course the humpback whales and other creatures that feed on those right here in New York Harbor. We have migratory birds that come in innumerable flocks here in Jamaica Bay and provide a spectacular vista. And of course, what we have a lot of is people. And again, it's that that opportunity to bring people back to the water, to that public space, for them to claim that resource that's theirs is what's so important to us. Whether it's going out and recreating having an opportunity to be close to nature and examine that wonder that we all feel when we see life on the planet. Now, of course, that's what inspired us, and we do have our challenges. I know we were talking earlier to one of my fellow speakers about some of the water quality challenges. So this is a combined sewer overflow in Perth Amboy, New Jersey. Unfortunately, when it rains, the waters from the street, from the sidewalks, combine with sewage, and because the sewage treatment plants can't handle it, that gets dumped directly into our waterways. So that's a challenge that we still have to address both in New Jersey and in New York. Of course, we have emerging threats like microplastics that are just now beginning to be able to be monitored and understood in terms of their impact on life. And of course, climate change. That sort of global crisis that really is top of mind, both in terms of what it's going to be in the future, but what it is today. Both in terms of the resiliency of our natural systems as well as our communities. But I also have hope. And, the reason I have hope is that, we've been able to solve these problems before, whether it's in Shinnecock Bay or here in New York and New Jersey. And it really results from people coming together around a common goals and common vision. And so here in New York, we have the Hudson-Raritan Estuary Comprehensive Restoration Plan that was has been signed on through the Harbor and Estuary Program by the two states, EPA, the Army Corps of Engineers, the Port Authority, and numerous civic organizations. And that brings together all the folks who are working on habitat enhancement around the 12 target ecosystem characteristics that we've identified as being our kind of common goals. And you know, that includes rebuilding the oyster reefs that once ringed Manhattan and New York Harbor and taking that to scale. You know, we were talking before about the Billion Oyster Project and the fantastic work that they do along with other civic partners in engaging our young people, whether it's through the Harbor School on Governor's Island or in other classrooms around the city and around New Jersey, in the restoration and how valuable the oyster and that idea of oyster restoration has been to get people excited about restoration. And then, you know, go from that to thinking about the oyster reef and the way that oysters filter water and the way that those reefs support other populations. You know, what our challenge now is really taking that to scale, to be thinking about rebuilding reefs, not as pilots, not as demonstration projects, not as restoration stations, but as large pieces of civic infrastructure that will change the ecology here in the harbor. As we're seeing it happen now, this is up near the Tappan Zee Bridge on the Hudson River, about 30 miles north of here. Or Marsh Islands here in Jamaica Bay, where the Army Corps of Engineers and the Port Authority have worked together to beneficially reuse dredged material from our navigation channels to rebuild the marsh islands that existed in Jamaica Bay, and creating thousands of acres of habitat in a degraded ecosystem, and importantly, understanding that those islands of wetlands can also help mitigate wave heights and reduce the threat of storm surges and tidal flooding. And rebuilding our coastal infrastructure, too, here at Hunters Point in Queens, where we're learning new techniques for rebuilding our shorelines in a way that prevents erosion, obviously, you know, holds the landfill in place, which is what bulkheads do, but also provides, you know, natural and nature-based resiliency features that will absorb floodwaters and provide some ecological enhancement. And, of course, and again, most importantly to me, is that these kind of efforts are a way of engaging people, and especially young people like the Blue Explorers, in the work of restoring the ecosystem, of enhancing habitat, and about improving the community around us, not just the ecological community, but people as well. And, you know, hopefully, you know, providing a place for people to explore on their own this great public resource that we have right here in New York and New Jersey. So I would invite all of you to come join us. Every year we bring together organizations around the region at City of Water Day. This year we're supporting over 50 events around the region, everywhere from Paterson, New Jersey, to the Harlem River in the Bronx, to Governor's Island and Red Hook in Brooklyn, out to Jamaica Bay. And it's these civic organizations open their doors. They welcome in people to learn about the work that they're doing in their communities to restore nature where they live, and bring people out on kayaks and paddle boards. And we have outrigger canoes, all kinds of vessels. So it's a great celebration. And again, welcome you all to join. You can learn more about the events and figure out how to get there at cityofwaterday.org. And that is it for me.
Amazing. Thank you so much, Rob. And Sylvia sometimes mentions to say thank you, phytoplankton, when we breathe, because a healthy ocean, all the plant life in the ocean, is what's responsible for every second breath we take. And after hearing Ellen's presentation and Rob's presentation, I would like to say a big thank you to the clams and the oysters who filter our water and give us amazing clean water. So I hope we're all going away tonight with an increased sense of pride for oysters and clams, more so than just eating them. All right, moving along. Our next presenter, who I think will hear the story about the eel and where it originates, maybe, is HopeSpot champion of the Sargasso Sea, Dr. David Freestone. David is executive secretary of the Sargasso Sea Commission, established in 2014 pursuant to the Hamilton Declaration on Collaboration for the Conservation of the Sargasso Sea, which now has 10 signatory governments. A former deputy general counsel and senior advisor at the World Bank, he is now visiting scholar at George Washington University Law School in Washington, D.C. He has written widely on the law of the sea and international environmental law, and is co-founder and editor-in-chief of the International Journal of Marine and Coastal Law. David's going to educate and inspire us on why it's important to protect the high seas, and talk briefly about the High Seas Treaty, which after two decades of ongoing discussion, the United Nations delegates from 193 nations reached a historic agreement on March 4th of this year. Yes? To protect marine biodiversity and address climate change in international waters, also known as the high seas. Please welcome David.
Thanks very much, Shannon. And my thanks very much to the Explorers Club and to Mission Blue, to Sylvia and Shannon for the invitation to be here. And Ted actually remembers I've spoken here before with great pleasure, and always it's always a great pleasure to be here. It's one of the great venues, I think, to speak. So Shannon called me and said, I'd like you to speak about the impact of the, you know, tell us what you've been doing, a little update, and then the impact of the new High Seas Treaty. So I said, so you're going to give me like an hour and a half? And I heard that my friend Francois Bellet from the UN got 3 hours. Well, I've got 8 minutes and I've reused one already, so I've got a lot to get through. So bear with me, and I'm happy to answer questions afterwards, of course. So first of all, the not brown algae, the golden floating rainforest of the Sargasso, of the Atlantic. And that's Sylvia's phrase. This is Sylvia's photo. This is the group brown. In that picture, I think that's the Photoshop. But that's it's an amazing place. And I think it was it Charles Forster who said about hotels? Location, 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 right? It's where it is. When it's in the Sargasso Sea, it's fine. When it's on the beaches of the Dominican Republic, no. But that's our fault, and I'd be happy to talk about that as a separate issue. But as a natural habitat, it's an amazing place. I like to think, in fact, Sylvia acknowledged when she was talking about this, that it's the expedition to the Sargasso Sea in 2009 that gave her the idea for the Hope Spots, which she did elaborate in the TED Talk. So we were like an early mover with this, but we relaunched a couple of years ago with the commission, now the Sargasso Sea Commissioner's champion. So we've been in the system for a long time. So it's a unique open ocean ecosystem based on the floating sargassum. It's hollow pelagic, never touches the ground. It's not like kelp, it doesn't touch the ground, so it reproduces by fragmentation. And it's very important for the life species of many, history of many species, including eels, right? I've got time to tell that story, but I'll refer to it. Turtles, it's the lost years. The Atlantic turtles spend their lost years, those little years between they were being on the beach and the big guys, amongst the sargassum, where they eat it. It has a nurturing environment, the temperature's warmer, etc., protective. And also for tunas, for billfishes, sharks, and cetaceans. So a lot of systems, a lot of species as well. First of all, where is it, right? It's not off the beaches of the Dominican Republic. It's actually here, around the islands of Bermuda. And Bermuda is actually, the government of Bermuda is one of our real champions in this project. So it's in the what's called should we go that way? It's anticyclonic. This is the Gulf Stream. This is the gyre, the North Atlantic subtropical gyre. And these currents, the Gulf Stream and the Azores Current and then the Antilles Current, hold this system in place. So there's plastic there as well, but it holds sargassum in place. And it's the only place in the world where the anguillid eels, Atlantic anguillid eels, the European eel, Anguilla anguilla, and Anguilla rostrata, the American eels, spawn in this area about 300 miles south of Bermuda. It's never been witnessed. It's one of the great mysteries of the ocean. I think it was Schmidt, 100 years ago, actually put forward the idea that they actually spawned, that eels spawned in this area of the Sargasso Sea. We don't know why. We've never witnessed it. But last year, and a number of my colleagues were actually involved in the project, eels were released from the Azores. Tagged eels were released from the Azores, and they found their way to this place south of Bermuda, where they're on the convergence zone. So we know it's right, but we still don't know so very little about it. The only reason we've ever really been able to work that out is by retrofitting, if you like, the size of the eggs that are found at various points. And the eels, they're the reverse of salmon. Salmon breed in fresh water and find their way to the ocean, open ocean. Anadromous, the eels are catadromous, and they find their way the opposite way. So they swim, the European eels swim 3,000 miles to this place where they spawn and die, and the little guys find their way back. So it's an amazing story, and the American eels, similarly to the big islands of the Caribbean and to the west coast. So it's an amazing story. It's only part of it. They're not, pictures of eels are not very iconic. I think I may have one later on. But the others are also, so turtles, cetaceans as well. And there's been a big surge in sushi trade. There's a huge aquaculture industry in China, which is using glass eels imported from all over the world, a lot of it illegally, in order to fatten them up and re-export them into the sushi trade. So that's driving the price of, there's one point in Maine where the price of a kilo of eels was worth more than cocaine. It's like $5,000 a pound. They're not in the market for cocaine or eels, but that's what I'm told. So amazing system. And of course, you talked about, it was in the Sargasso Sea that Prochlorococcus, I've been practicing that, was actually discovered, right? That's the oxygen giving. So here we are, same picture, same issue then. Unique open ocean system, eels, turtles, tunas, particularly big eyes as well as marlin, which are endangered, and the poor beagles. We think the poor beagles, which are also endangered, actually eat the eels when they pop in the Sargasso Sea. They come from the St. Lawrence River down into the Sargasso Sea, spawn. No, they don't spawn, they pop. They give live birth, and then we think they do it because they actually find all these eels they can eat, but that's not proven as well. So two endangered species competing here. 70 years of continuous ocean quality monitoring because of the presence of the Bermuda International Ocean Institute in BIOS in Bermuda, which is spun off from Woods Hole. And a classic example of high seas area without regional management organizations. And this is really what spawned this project. This is an iconic high seas system. It's very difficult to convince people in the street that high seas are interesting. It's just water, right? Whereas you can actually see the sargassum. It actually has a presence. And so the pictures and the species, which some endemic species as well, are actually quite charismatic. So it's a great, Sylvia's idea, the floating rainforest. It's an ideal opportunity, if you like, to picture the idea of important high seas areas. Some of the sargassum voracious predator, whose fins are adapted to walk through the sargassum, only 5 centimetres long, luckily. So these are the guys, these are the endemics. And lots of iconics we saw. So we haven't been able to find the blue fins actually go through the. It would be wonderful if they spawned in the Sargasso Sea. We'd be able to close the place off completely. But no, they swim through it at the time of other spawning elsewhere. And of course, eels as well. So how do we move forward with this? So the Sargasso Elite Sea Alliance was formed in 2010. In 2014, we had a major meeting in Bermuda, guess who was there? And we, five governments at that point signed the Hamilton Declaration, which we'd heard from Shannon. And Sylvia was our champion then and remains major champion for us. Those are the passes. We actually had about 10 government representatives there. They were considering their position, and we now, and that includes the UK, the US, Canada, Bermuda, of course, the Azores, British Virgin Islands, Dominican Republic, Bahamas. So we've got 10 existing, as I said, 10 governments there. They all are. So some of them signed later on. And we've got a number of other, the EU is still interested, Netherlands, Sweden, etc., been supporting us. And we actually have now 35 collaborating organizations, both scientific organizations like Woods Hole, but also, you know, the universities around the world. Very light governance structure. I mean, the signatories meet now. They used to meet every year, but during COVID, they said they started to meet every 2 months, which is quite good. So now becoming really involved. Sargasso Sea Commission is unusual because these are not appointed by the signatories. They are actually appointed on the nomination of the signatories by the government of Bermuda, and they meet. They serve in their personal capacity, international scientists and persons of. Who are committed to ocean conservation, and we have a very small secretariat. I like to say lean and mean, and I'm not the lean one. So those are our current current commissioners from Bermuda, from the UK, from Bahamas, from Canada, as well, US, and from the Azores. And then, right, the treaty. So, I don't know how many minutes I've used. I'm borrowed time. So, this is President Lena Rhee at the Namaste when she finally, after eight, this has been talking about this treaty for the idea of the treaty for 2 decades, and they've actually been negotiating since 2017, interrupted. So, this is a major achievement. What does it do? It's a bit of a red herring. I can talk about it later, but I mean, it has a benefit sharing arrangements for marine genetic resources from the high seas. So developing countries could benefit from it. But more importantly, for our purposes, it recognizes what it calls rather kind of convoluted area based management tools, and these include MPAs. So for the first time, the conference of the parties of this treaty, when it comes into force. Will be able to declare and recognize areas of the high seas as marine protected areas. And that's been the trouble that we've been having as the Sargasso Sea Commission, as the Sargasso Sea Project generally, because there is no international mechanism to do this currently. So we've had to be working with the fisheries organization, we've worked with the seabed authority, we've worked with the IMO, the International Maritime Organization, and the Conventional Migratory Species. We've had some successes. We actually have all the seamounts in the Sargasso Sea, which are under the jurisdiction of NAFO, have been declared off limits. They've had a demersal trawling ban on those, fishing ban. But it's been a long process, even after 10 years. So this is a major breakthrough for us. It also has important requirements for environmental impact assessment and maybe strategic impact environmental assessment as well. And that's kind of what we're doing at the moment, and then capacity building. So last real slide here, we've got 10 governments. We've just got a grant from the Global Environment Facility, $3 million, with support also from the French, another $1 million from the French. And we're doing a socio-ecosystem diagnostic analysis, a bit of a mouthful, but it's basically a strategic environmental assessment. What's the state of it? Where are we going? What are the pressures? What do we need to do for the future in order to put a sustainable program in place for its conservation, but also sustainable management? And then at the end of that, we'll have a collaborative strategic action program, which we hope and expect the Global Environment Facility will support. So we're still hoping, we've been hoping for 12 years, we've been doing pretty well, I think. We're hoping, and can we go back one, please? Thanks. Hoping and planning to pilot this new MPA protection opportunity. It's not a low-hanging fruit. This is difficult. You have to make the case, you have to make a case very coherently, you have to have champions and partners to take you with you. But we hope that once that treaty comes into force, this will be an opportunity for us to be at least among the first to do that. So thank you very much for your attention. What I love about cetaceans as well here, so we have humpbacks. They like the feeling of the sargassum on their bodies, so they swim in amongst it. So this is a lovely picture from our big ally and collaborator in Bermuda. Unfortunately, because they like that, they also means they do the same with discarded nets, so it causes some problems. But this is a lovely picture of sargassum, the good side of sargassum. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, David, and thank you for all your hard work for the high seas trading. We need people like you, lawyers that are behind the scenes pushing for policy and protection, so thank you so much. So we've gone from clams and oysters and restoration projects and why they work to high seas, to treaties, to sargassum, one of Sylvia's favorite. And I agree with the whale. If I was a whale and I was trying to get rid of some whale lice or something else, swimming through that would be good because I have swam through it and it is scratchy. So there's that. And before we introduce our final speakers of this portion of the session tonight, we have an exciting announcement to make, and we have a short video that we want to share with all of you. Please play the video.
I'm so pleased to welcome Northeast Iceland as a hope spot. With champions Belen Garcia Ovide and Charlin Basran with Ocean Missions. Eva Bjork, director of Husavik Whale Museum. In this area, just beneath the surface, a vibrant world of geothermal vents, upwelling currents, nutrient-rich waters, and a place where biodiversity proliferates in a dynamic environment. This region hosts deep water ecosystems, as well as sandy, shallow areas and rocky places where kelp forests thrive. It provides habitat for resident species and migratory pathways for others. There are 20 cetacean species, 7 pinniped species, nearly 40 nesting bird species, including 16 that are seabirds, 126 known kinds of fish, and at least 47 species of invertebrates are found here. The entire area is an important whale feeding area for humpback whales, minke whales, and even the endangered North Atlantic blue whale. Skjalfandi Bay and the town of Húsavík are known as the whale capital of Iceland, where hundreds of whales, dolphins, and porpoises feed each year, and thousands of people come to visit them. As well as being one of the strongest Atlantic puffin colonies in Iceland that thrives on Lundy Island. Among the special features of this hope spot are the longest fjord in Iceland, underwater hydrothermal vents creating a unique and isolated ecosystem, and a place that is home for the largest Arctic tern breeding colony in all of Europe. This hope spot is a significant step toward the goal for Iceland to protect at least 30% of the ocean by 2030. I'm so pleased to welcome Northeast Iceland as a hope spot.
I mean, just play it again, because it was incredible, right? Could I get a light on up here so I can read my notes? Thank you so much. All right, congratulations to Belen Garcia Ovide and Dr. Charla Jean Basran for the designation of the first hope spot in Iceland. Belen is a marine biologist, wildlife guide, and experienced sailor based in Iceland who works in ocean conservation and sustainability in the Arctic regions. Belen received her MRM in coastal and marine management from the University of Westfjords, Iceland, where she studied marine acoustics, in particular whale watching, boat noise, and effects on humpback whales. In 2017, she started working as a wildlife guide during whale watching tours and sailing expeditions in the Arctic for North Sailing, and more recently as an environmental advisor. In 2019, she founded Ocean Missions, nonprofit organization in Húsavík, Iceland, where through a combination of research, citizen science, education, and traditional sailing, her mission is to inspire the world to take direct actions to protect the oceans. Belén is also a Safina Center Fellow and has been promoted as a potential PhD student for the EWELL project. Joining Belén is Dr. Sharla Jean-Basran, scientific advisor at Ocean Missions in Iceland, is a marine biologist, whale researcher with a master's in marine and coastal management, and PhD in biology focused on whale entanglement and fishing gear. She has been passionate about the ocean from a young age and worked on marine research from sea stars to whales for over 10 years. Her main area of interest is contributing research that helps to find a harmonic balance between human uses of the ocean and preservation of ocean ecosystems, as well as participating in citizen science projects that contribute to spreading awareness about ocean-related issues and encouraging people to make a positive change. Please welcome our newest Hope Spot champions, Belén and Sharla.
Thank you, Shannon. Well, first of all, thank you very much to Mission Blue team and for the Explorers Club for the opportunity to be here today. It's quite emotional, and we come all the way from Iceland for the launching of officially of the first Hope Spot in Iceland. So thank you very much. So let's start the presentation. Since we had an amazing introduction from yourself, from Shannon, I'm going to skip this slide. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about our organization that is called Ocean Missions. It's a non-profit organization that is based in Húsavík in the northeast of Iceland. And our mission is to inspire people to take direct actions to protect our oceans. We began our efforts in 2019 because of the deep need of ocean conservation and sustainable development in these fragile Arctic and subarctic regions. So we do this through a combination of sailing, education, and sailing traditions. And we use a schooner opal here in the picture, which is a wonderful wooden ship, also hybrid electric, by the way, to execute citizen science expedition in Iceland with the aim of training people from all over the world to become ocean ambassadors. During our citizen science expeditions, we study whales, seabirds, noise pollution, and plastic pollution. We also work very closely with the local communities in Iceland on ocean literacy and education in order to spark the interest of the locals for ocean protection. Of course, we are very inspired by Sylvia Earle and her team, and because we believe that our values and our hope for the future of our oceans aligns very well with the way that Mission Blue connects people and organizations from all over the world on the name of ocean conservation. And through an inspiring connection with one of the Blue Mission members, which is Liz Cunningham, author and a very inspiring person, we were encouraged to declare the first Hope Spot in Iceland. So in Iceland, less than 1% of the oceans are fully protected. And in fact, there is a lack of ocean law and regulations that are tackling the problems. So it is of crucial importance to have these initiatives and to create protected marine spaces. So this is our Hope Spot area in the northeast of Iceland. It's a very incredible place where ocean ecosystems thrive. We have a mix of currents, warm currents coming from the Gulf Stream that mixes with cold Arctic currents. It is a place that is located at the edge of the Arctic, and the fact that it lies between the Arctic Ocean and the North Atlantic Ocean, it's a very important fact that it becomes a beacon of hope of protection of these both oceans. As you can see, the area has also four islands, and they are all connected by a very interesting ocean dynamics. And we can divide the Hope Spot in three main areas. So you can see Skjalvandi Bay, here. This is by Húsavík town, as was said in the video. It's also considered to be the capital of the whale watching in Iceland. Here we have Eyjafjörður, which is the longest fjord in Iceland. And then on the top in the north, we have Grímsey Island, which is the most northern tip of Iceland, where the country crosses the Arctic Circle. Charlotte?
So we just wanted to highlight again a little bit of some of the amazing things in our hope spot. One of the major draws for people coming there is the whales. There's been 20 different species recorded, not just whales, but also dolphins and porpoises, of course. You're seeing four of the main ones on the screen. The white-beaked dolphins, which actually live there all year round, and then there's several migratory species coming to feed, such as the humpback whales, the minke whales, and even the endangered blue whale. It's one of the most common places and reliable places right now to see the Atlantic blue whale every year, which is exciting. Also, a major draw to the area is the big bird colonies, some of the strongest and largest in Europe. Before the video mentioned the Atlantic puffins in Iceland in general, they have the largest population of puffins, and two of the strongest colonies fall within the Hope Spot area on Lunde Island and Grímsey Island. Also, as mentioned, the largest Arctic tern colony, as well as amazing other seabird cliffs such as razorbills and kittiwakes. There's many other things we could tell you in this short time that are wonderful in this Hope Spot. It is an upwelling area, confluence of currents, as we talked about, and also major rivers running into the area. And all of this is providing the base of the food chain. So phytoplankton, zooplankton, the fish, and then that's, of course, what is supporting the whales and birds that are drawing so much attention to our area now. Also, the Greenland shark is definitely worth mentioning. It's mysterious, very interesting. It's believed to be the longest living vertebrate in the world. The new estimate is possibly 500 years, which is unbelievable. Also, seal colonies. There's been seven different pinniped species recorded, and there are local colonies of harbor and gray seals. And worth mentioning again is definitely the very unique hydrothermal vent ecosystem in Eyjafjörður, which is in relatively shallow waters, and you can actually take a eco-tourism diving trip and actually visit this ecosystem, which is actually protected already, which is wonderful. Of course, we have a lot of hope for our Hope Spot. We have current action going on and a lot of hope for the future. As you can imagine, given all the things we just mentioned, it's a major place for research. Whale research through the University of Iceland, bird research through the Northeast Iceland Nature Center, and also climate change and climate justice research through the Stephenson Arctic Institute. Ourselves at Ocean Missions and also our partners such as the Húsavík Whale Museum, we run education and outreach programs, especially for children in the schools, to try to inspire the next generation of ocean protectors. Also, we are undergoing now microplastic and macroplastic research within the Hope Spot area at Ocean Missions. Since 2019, we've actually started microplastic trawling. We do this on week-long expeditions using schooner opal, which you saw already. And actually, this year, we are going to have a special Hope Spot expedition within the area where we are going to run a citizen science trip specifically in the Hope Spot area to teach people about this wonderful place and about the threats that it's facing and hopefully push conservation forwards there. And we're also doing macroplastic research since 2020. We are part of the Icelandic Cleanup Network, which is sponsored by the Icelandic government to clean up the beaches. We've cleaned up over 15 tons of debris off the beaches, a lot of very heavy fishing gear in that area. And we are using the OSPAR survey protocols. So we are actually collecting standardized data on all of our beach cleanups as well, so we know what debris is showing up there and when. our major hope and goal for the future of this area is to now start pushing forwards legal marine protection, which is kind of just gaining some momentum and so far has been kind of lacking in Iceland. So some of the things that are going on, ourselves and also many colleagues, we formed a group that's dubbed Sveaves. It has an Icelandic name that's difficult, but it is a regional organization that is now organizing marine protection from the bottom up. And one of the first things we want to get going with that is to start stakeholder involvement. We are planning a wide-ranging survey throughout the communities so that we can start collecting everybody's vision for the future of the marine protection and sustainable use of this area, because there is a lot of things going on there, tourism, fishing, etc. And expanding our actions and our outreach, we are based in Husavik, and now the Hope Spot, I think, is definitely going to shine light and help us expand this into Eyjafjörður and Grímsey more. And for this fall, we have kind of a call to action planned. We have a two-day event where we are having stakeholder meetings and also inviting governmental, both local and national members, as also international experts who know a lot about marine protection and how to create marine protected areas. And so we are going to host that this fall to start getting the groundwork laid, thanks, I think, a lot to the recognition of the Hope Spot, to make this a legal marine protected area. So that's everything. Thank you so much from Belen and I, and also thank you very much to all of our partners and everybody who's been supporting us along the way. It's been an honor to be here and launch this Hope Spot.